I think I didn't take seriously enough what people told me about how different the institution Brown is. When I see my colleagues at conferences and things like that, is I tell them about the magnificent students first. I say, you know, teaching is just so much fun, and it's like you're on this journey with them. You can be innovative in the classroom, and the students will come along on that with you. They're prepared to try things out, not just in terms of the material you're teaching, but in how you're teaching it. Brown to me seemed like an opportunity to be more creative, more fluid, because it's diverse. It's a place where I could branch out and not feel odd. I get to work on whatever I want and not feel that I'm not fulfilling societal norms within my scientific community. I actually started in engineering. I was in a classroom with 200 guys and me and one other woman, and it was not a very friendly environment. And in my math classes, there were lots of women. I thought, oh, I might just go over there. So what I actually did was I majored in math. I did a summer research project at the Bureau of Meteorology, because weather forecasting is very mathematically based. And I thought, well, that's pretty useful, you know, to being able to forecast storms and things like that. And so I ended up drifting into atmospheric science. When I went to Australia, I went back there, and I was known for my work with the Inupiat Eskimos in far north Alaska and helping them deal with floods and erosion and storms and sea ice retreat. And so the Australian government said, well, of course, you can just come and do that, do your magic with Australian Indigenous people. And I said, no, the context is everything. And then for whatever reason, a group of Yorta Yorta people, who are one of the most popular Indigenous nations in Australia, heard about me and heard about my work and invited me to come up and meet with them. I went up there and we just sat and we chatted. I had with me my boss at the time. He said, what was that? What was that all about? We didn't achieve anything. We didn't get a presentation on climate change in Australia. What were we doing there? And I said, we were just chatting. They wanted to know who we were. They wanted to know where we were from. I got a message afterwards saying, they like you. They'd like you to come up and chat to them again. And this happened over a year and a half. And then we started talking about the environment and climate change and those kinds of things. And it evolved from there. One of the things that I've really thought about in communicating climate change is that it's not a purely cognitive process. That talking to people about the science of climate change and this is how it works and this is how we understand it doesn't help people to get to a very deep personal understanding of what the environment means to them. A lot of artists are working on that problem, working on our relationship with space, our relationship with the environment, how we are in the environment, who we are in the environment, who is nature without us, all of those questions. A lot of artists are exploring that. For me, a lot of how I think about my relationship to the environment is through those kind of non-cognitive processes. If that's how I understand it, then I think that that's something that we could teach about and think about and explore with the students. Carve out the time for people to say, it's not just okay for you to spend time doing this, it's important.